live in the dungeon. This is the Dream Warrior Review. I'm Kurt Thomas.
I'm Mick Strawn.
To continue our series.
Right. Castle Rock.
We're almost at episode 10, I think. Is this episode 9? Yeah.
Is that what's happening?
So I think there's 10 episodes that I know of that are out there.
Can I just say one thing? I just had one.
Oh, there we go.
Yeah, it helps if you put them on your ears. I just have one question. When are we?
Actually, that was my reaction for half the... what?
Right.
Huh? So this episode's called Henry Deaver.
Right.
So if you've been watching this at all...
Yeah, you would know
this
that...
This episode... Henry, if you start with this episode, it might be like the first episode. But it's not
It's not really, because it's... Yeah.
It's not about when. It's about.
I don't know what this
what?
Is
about. What well, the?
The question is this is when, and obviously we're involved in a million timelines going on here. What I don't understand is, there's something about my brain and probably everybody else's brain. Our natural inclination is to set things in order.
Mm-hmm.
And this is how we form societies. This is how we get up in the morning and we set things in order. In fact, one of the worst things that can happen to you is you get Alzheimer's and things don't seem in order anymore. And you completely get out of the stream of humanity. And that's what happens with this show. You don't know when you are. And
especially this episode.
Yeah, especially this episode.
But it followed the same storyline, more or less.
Pull it up. You know what? You're shirking your job. Your job here is when we come in here, we start a film, and you have pulled it up on IMDb. Man, go to the cast.
Where's my friend Alexa when I need her? Melanie Linsky.
Yeah. Yep.
The girl that was in Two and a Half Men.
Right, Two and a Half Men. Yeah. I love this girl. I'm telling you, her acting, her chops on this just are awesome.
What'd you think of Skarsgård? He kind of, at first I was like, uh-oh, that's his voice, I think. And then he was actually playing a straight character, just
right,
normal.
Right, straight and a normal character, and it worked pretty well.
Yeah.
But you know what? The thing is she wore it better.
She took this one.
She wore it better. She took it. You know, to me it's kind of been... kind of a contest. each time we start another show of this, another episode of this.
Sissy's Basic took one episode.
That's right. Yeah. And the one before Sissy Spacek was the sheriff.
Yeah.
Forget his name.
Alan. The character's name's Alan.
Right. Right. You know, he took it earlier and it was the lawyer, you know. And it's funny is they all seem to grab their stories, but Sissy Spacek and her... Yep. Yeah, it was, of course, Scott Glenn. Sissy Spacek and her, Melanie, have really, really impressed me.
Well, I like the guy who plays Harry Deaver, Andre Holland. I mean, I've seen him in a lot of other things that I just like him as an actor.
Yeah.
I mean, he's not like an amazing, like, you know, like level actor like Sissy Spacek, but he's carried a lot of episodes. But until now.
And he's the sheriff, right?
No,
he's the deputy.
Attorney.
Oh, he's the attorney. Oh, right. I'm sorry. He's the attorney. I'll tell you who I
Henry
also
Deaver.
Like.
One of the Henry Deavers.
I also like a lot. I like the deputy. No.
He was a prison guard.
He's a prison guard, right.
But then in this episode.
He's a deputy.
He's a deputy.
Yeah. Well, and you know why? It's because we don't know when we are.
Right. So this episode was like interesting because like halfway through it was like, okay, everything's completely different, but it has a similar story, similar theme.
Right.
But then at the end, some weird things happen and you're not so sure anymore.
Yeah. And you don't know. You're not going to say it again. That's what's driving me crazy.
There's
you don't
some
know
weird
when
stuff
you are.
Too, like
yeah.
A woo, 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 woo.
Yeah. I had a certain problem with the fact that back to back, we seem to have had a couple of stories that are trying to explain
what we saw previously.
Or trying to coalesce some of the things.
Well, how does the last episode fit with this one? That's where I'm like lost. I'm like...
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying is yeah.
Like these two episodes are kind of like almost like they're restarting
something.
I
tell you though, that there is something about this. I love the propping in this episode. The propping all the way through this show is amazing because it tells...
You mean like the little bus with the statue next to it?
Right. The tapes.
Oh, the tapes, yeah. In the box.
Yeah. You know, somebody thought it all through and
they even had the proper dust and everything.
Yeah, yeah. Like, and yeah. That was a lot of work. I mean, you know, the thing is I give... The set dressing, see, the art department overall in this is amazing. The set dressing in the house, because this house keeps changing so much. And, you know, that element to it of not quite a hoarder, but, and they didn't do hoarder. They did an intelligent person that's just lost the will.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. And I love that, you know, that they didn't go to the point of, you know, of the hoarder, which is, you know, wrapping newspapers up in string and stuff like that.
Well, it's a whole different thing.
Oh, which all of a sudden just makes me remember something. Wow.
His brain is revving up.
I was working on Fever, and what brought this to mind was Hoarder.
Story time with Mick.
I was working on Fever, and we got this. And you talk about problems that you get.
Yeah.
Sam Neill, Armando Sante, filming a lot around Los Angeles. Sam Neill was the coolest guy, and especially in that he never argued with the director. Mm-hmm. The director was a complete tool, but he was an old tool. He was 70. He was 72-year-old tool, and kind of talked like, "Yeah, well, you f***heads, and you have no idea what you're talking about." You know, back in my day, you know, he used to tell me this. He gave me. I came on as production designer, and he hands me a list. I swear to God, this happened. He says, "You know what? I don't give a crap what this thing looks like, but this is a list of my favorite restaurants. You just make sure that I can go to lunch at one of these restaurants every day, and we'll get along okay." Well, to tell you the truth, we didn't get along okay from the start. So. Not like I gave a crap one way or the other.
Right.
But he was interesting, though. He did teach me some really interesting things about film. You know, you get somebody who had that much experience, and he would mix his shots. He would do an office shot of somebody coming into the office, as opposed to somebody coming into the office, sitting down on a chair, you doing back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth like this. He would bring him into the office on a dolly, and then or use a Steadicam, mm-hmm. right? And then he would come up on a two shot, watch the two of them talk, and then carry the two shot around the two of them, so that as the conversation went back and forth, he would be to the major point of the conversation. He would be on their face over the shoulder, and then keep coming back and then going around like that. And he would all set it up like an entire scene on a single shot, but a really interesting shot that you could cut in and out of with a couple of close-ups, right? And then
is that so you could readjust the camera?
Right, like, right. And he'd tell it to his first AD, you know, have the camera guys set this all up, and then they would choreograph it.
Wow.
Then he would shoot it. And the thing is then he told me this because I asked him about it, and he said, well, you know, he says, what we want, the thing is we're not going to roll until probably 11:30, just before lunch, he says. But here's the thing: once we're done, you know, once we do this shot, I'm just gonna go home for the day, and I'll have my first AD do just a bunch of close-up pops, or, you know, close-up shots, go through the whole dialogue in the close-up, and then run through everybody that's in the scene, and then I can edit out of that, and the funny thing is it had a real look to it for his being able to do that, and it looked better than the little film, it wasn't your typical everyday hack shots. So he actually was using this device of mixing these shots to make it look better.
Right. Well, you can do that cheat with if you have one camera, make it look like you have more than one camera.
Right. Exactly. Well, very much the same way.
Yeah.
And you know what? I remember when I started talking about this, I had an idea of where I was going, and now I am completely lost. But Sam Neill. I was going to say about Sam Neill. Sam Neill had a tendency to drop dialogue.
Oh man!
You know, it's great because it was a really wordy script. You know, and Sam Neill didn't. He would like do something. Like every take, he'd do something a little bit different, and he'd drop out a little bit of dialogue. And what he did replaced that dialogue. See what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I mean, he was a master at it. And the thing is this director actually kind of just rode with it and said, okay, great, you know, take it away. And, you know,
he was a pretty good actor.
Yeah, he's a really good. Well, even then, he had already done, you know, that one with the little dinosaurs. Oh, Jurassic Park.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, that little one.
That little the one, 90s that Jurassic at some Park point. Thing. So, yeah, no. But it was just really interesting to be to watch. I literally thought that the continuity woman girl was going to hang herself.
Really?
Yeah, because she would get up and just get absolutely incensed, going, you know. I don't know how to market because as opposed to, so the director would keep the takes, right? And she'd go, well, wait a minute. I don't know how to mark that you kept the tape, that you have these takes and each one of them is completely different from each other. And so anyway, that argument pretty much went all the way, you know, along the film, but you know, it actually was a really good film. Huh. And
it was called Fever.
It's called Fever. Look at our Monasantes.
It's like open window.
Oh yeah, Armonasante.
Armand.
Any other passion in the paradise? Jack the Ripper. Fever, right there.
Fever. Oh, yeah. TV movie. 1991.
Oh, was it a TV movie? Yeah. What do I know? So anyway, what were we talking about?
We were talking about Castle Rock.
Oh, Castle Rock, and I was talking.
We're okay. Talking about episode 9 called Henry Deaver.
Oh yeah, and I was mentioning the incredible art department, which yes. Really, I love the art department on this whole thing.
I think the sound is always good too.
You know what? And the thing is, there was something that was kind of like disturbing in this one shot that I thought was really cool. Is there was a really wide shot at the very beginning. They're coming, and it's looking down on the town as he's coming into town on this, right? And it's really wide and long. And there's a house over here that's burning.
Oh yeah.
Just burning.
Just burning.
Just
yeah.
Burning. Oh, look at that. There's a house burning.
Well, I thought it was weird, too. Was that he burned out. He set the fire at that big, I guess it was an orphanage or...
Right, right.
But, and then they just let him go to somebody's house.
Yeah, that was not very believable.
No.
You know? And maybe they did it back then, but maybe. Back then is now. So, you know, I don't know.
Well, when is now?
Well, yeah. When is it? When...
In fact,
when is this?
You've actually, well, one thing you pointed out to me,
yeah,
that I've been paying attention to now is the sound in,
yeah,
every episode now.
Right. Am I right about,
yeah,
it? It's, yeah. It's like there's a device in here.
I like
that
the
is
bell,
a,
the long, church.
Yeah, boom.
They kind of bend it a little bit.
Yeah, they kind of bend it. Like that. That's what I'm saying is they're manipulating all the sound in the background.
They're starting to get a little hum.
They, yeah.
Through
hum,
things.
And they got this hum as, that goes along and that really low note that always, that you don't even notice it until it changes right. pitch a little bit and then drops back down yep. again. You know, and I think that in a way that they're trying to like do this sound thing that's the voice of God. That's
well, that's
you
know, the hum that
it's the hum.
Hearing.
Yeah, and it's cool. I like that underneath the sound. I love the fact that sound is so important in films. It is so much more important than people think because cheap and bad sound. Mm. Can ruin a great film, you know. It really can, and it can. Good sound can elevate a really small film immensely.
Yeah, I've seen some Charlie Chaplin movies that just have no sound effects, and it pisses me off.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm just kidding. Never
well,
mind.
You know,
no,
what?
But you're totally right.
I think the really perfect example of is that really heinous
Tyler Perry.
Tyler Perry film that we saw and they didn't go in and adjust any of the, it's almost like they just ran the recordings.
Well, there are certain points where more than half the movie was fine.
Right.
But then when they're in this one set, it was awful. It's like it was like
the
opposite.
Two sets. One was
oh,
the kitchen.
Sets. Yeah, the
remember,
kitchen.
One was the kitchen. The other one was just briefly inside of that one house.
Yeah.
And the sound was terrible in both of them. You're like, wow, you couldn't have fixed that.
They could have fixed. Yeah.
They didn't care. They didn't no. care. Don't care. Don't care. Don't care. But sound is difficult though because sound, you know, looping sound is very expensive and it isn't very good. You know, it's you're trying to avoid that at all costs and. And I keep, it's funny, we, you know, I've been working with one of these 72-hour challenges, you know, that you make a film in 72 hours. And they're talking about, well, what sound do we let through? And they go, you know what, you don't let any sound through. The only sound that you worry about is you worry about your main run of sound, your actors talking. That's it.
You don't worry about background at all?
You don't worry, you don't, absolutely
really?
Not. You put your back room back in. That's why you.
Oh, well, I'm talking about like if we're in this room.
Foley artists,
there's a lot of noise in this dungeon.
Right.
So wouldn't I want to record the background noise
well,
in case I needed
and
to?
And the thing
use
is,
it.
Is nowadays what they do is they would take and they would run the recording of this room.
Right.
And in a sophisticated way, they would find everything that's within a certain repeating pattern,
mm-hmm.
and they would make like the mirror image of it.
Oh, okay.
In sound waves and just blast it and it goes away. Pop, 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 pop,
oh,
pop,
yeah.
pop.
Okay.
And then they've got a place
well,
to
you can
start
redo,
from.
You can there's other ways to remove sound now. Obviously.
Well, there's
digital.
Yeah. I mean, but that's
frequency
the digital way that they
yeah.
do frequency manipulation.
Yeah.
Anything that's running evenly can be eliminated pretty easily. So then.
That's how we get the rat that's snoring over there in the corner. We always cut it out. You never hear it.
I thought you gave him
it's
some
a
cheese
big rat,
so he would go away.
He's the size of a 20-pound cat.
Yeah,
I mean, what?
Exactly.
We can't get rid of him.
I thought that was one of your kids.
He's our no. Looks, it resembles me a lot. But
well, yeah.
No.
I,
and we do put a diaper on him.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's the diaper that tipped me off.
So anyway,
the thing is this is what you want to do is you want to keep the sound of your main characters and that way you can take that sound and it'll lip with the situation, mm-hmm. you know, and you can then add everything else in. And as you're adding it in, that way everything else is going to match all the way through the scene. Everything else, you know, is going to be at its own sound level and you can adjust it and mm-hmm. stuff. You know, it's like the difference between taking a live recording of a band
mm-hmm.
and going into a studio and isolating each one of their instruments
right.
and reassembling it completely on your own, you know, with the sound guy and stuff. You know,
right.
It really makes a difference.
Yeah. I can
so,
see that.
What did you think of this episode of... What are we listening to?
Castle Rock.
Oh, I was going to say Hangar 13.
Close.
Close.
Henry Deaver.
Castle Rock. Henry. I
was kind of annoyed at the first 10 minutes. But
I was.
But then I was like, okay, I guess I can get into this. But so I'd probably rate it
3.3.
I was going to say 3.5 just because
I'm going to say 3.3.
I liked Bill Skarsgård's performance, and I thought that,
yeah,
like you said, Molly did an awesome job too. Melanie Lynskey.
Yeah, I mean, that's the only ways I would say 3.3, because here's the problem is an awful lot of this is kind of feels like Phil now.
Right.
You know?
Well, yeah.
I mean, I just want to say that If they have a conclusion to this and a reason for any of it within the next two,
yeah,
or one, how many episodes are there?
Well, they said they're going to do 10 this season. So,
well, but isn't this number 9?
Yeah.
Well, that's what I'm saying is I don't know if we're actually driving to a point, but if we were, it would have made a really, really, really good 2-hour long movie.
Yes.
So that's all I've got to say.
Yeah. So we're up to 9. So we have 10.
Really?
That'll be next week.
All of this? An hour and 50 minutes. An hour and 50 minutes stretched out to 9 hours.
What about episode 7?
Well, okay. Remove episode 7.
I mean, that's kind of a special episode of The Queen.
Yeah. Yeah. But, you know, the funny thing is that could have been a separate movie.
Yeah.
That could have been a separate movie done after the rest of these, right? See, this could have all been one film, right? Except for episode 7. And episode 7 could be the sequel.
Wow.
Ah. High five. Oh. Boy, that was embarrassing.
We actually hit that time.
Yeah. Yeah, last time we missed a lot. Okay, guys. Well, I think that we've rated it.
Yep. I think we're... Yeah, we've done a lot of work. We've done a lot of hard work.
A lot of hard work.
For one little episode.
Once again, I'm going to mention my book.
Yeah.
Beans is If I Don't Do It, Nobody Is. Behind the Screams book.com and order your copy. It's really good.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's worth it.
It surprised me.
In fact, hurry up and buy it before he raises the price and realizes
yes,
that he's
really
doing such a good deal.
It's going to happen because, honestly, you know, it costs a lot of money to print it that nice. It really did. I mean, this is not one of those books where, yeah, we'll make a book for you for $2.86. No, it's not that book.
That's right.
So, thank you. Thank you for thinking about buying my book. Thank you for listening to this podcast. Thank you for wiping.
It's always good to wipe.
I like it when people wipe.
It's okay. A good policy.
Yeah, there you go. Thanks for just being you. Aww. And remember, always eat a green thing.
Every day.
Every day.
Eat something green.
Eat something green.
And we're not talking about crayons. We're talking about food. I guess crayon could be food.
Yeah, crayon could be green. Not? Yeah, green. You know, some other food than vegetables can be green.
That's true.
Particularly mold.
I wouldn't recommend going around eating mold, though.
Yes, well, yeah. It could be good for you. It could be a trip. You don't know.
Well, I guess penicillin comes from mold.
Yeah, there you go. Anyway, have a nice day.
This is Kurt Thomas along with Mick Strawn. Thank you for listening to the Dream Warrior Review. If you have any questions or just have feedback for our show, we welcome them at dreamwarriorreview@gmail.com. Of course, you can find us on Facebook and Twitter as well. As always, please follow us and tell your friends about us too.